وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. صلى الله على النبي الأمي وآله صلى الله عليه وسلم، صلاة وسلام عليك يا رسول الله. ایک مرتبہ اور محبت کے ساتھ درود شریف نذرانہ پیش کیجیے. اللہ رب محمد صلی علیہ وسلم، نحن عباد محمد صلی علیہ وسلم، صلاۃ وسلام علیک یا رسول اللہ. It's been quite a long time since we ceased the durus al-Muhammadiyya from the book Al-Uhud Al-Muhammadiyya of Imam Al-Sha'rani radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And inshallah, hopefully, we shall begin afresh after the break of Ramadan and the ziyarah of Madinat al-Munawwara and our presence in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Makkah al-Mukarramah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it and make it a means of our salvation and a means of our forgiveness for the past and forthcoming sins, and make it a means of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala giving us immense tawfiq to do more righteous deeds and to abstain from things which He and His Prophet has prohibited, inshallah. I shall very briefly start, if I continue with the last dars that we did, if you recall, on the importance of giving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah ta'ala ki rah mein kharch karne ki fazil ke silsile mein jo humne bayan kiya tha, usi silsile ko aagaz karte hue ikhtisar ke sath aapke samne kuch ahadees se mubarak bayan ki jayegi. Uske baad mera irada tha ke guzishta hafte ek dars ho jata Sayyidna Hamza radhiyallahu ta'ala an ki shaan par, lekin na ho saka, to inshaallah aaj مختصراً آپ کی شان میں کچھ بیان کرنے کی کوشش کروں گا. So there's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam giving us the importance of giving in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of spending, of not being in fear of the fact that if you spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala it will diminish, rather whatever you spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will increase barakah in your risk. And this is why it has been noted that those people who give zakat, جو لوگ ہر سال زکات نکالتے ہیں اور صحیح طور پر شریعت کے قوانین کی پاسداری کرتے ہوئے زکات نکالتے ہیں, تو اللہ تعالیٰ ان کے رزق میں اور مزید برکت عطا فرماتا ہے کہ وہ آئندہ سال میں اور مزید زکات نکالتے ہیں. لیکن جو لوگ یوں سمجھتے ہیں, معاذ اللہ, جیسے کہ علامات قیامت میں سے from the signs of قیامت that people will take zakat as a tax on them, as a burden on them, یہ سمجھتے ہوئے لوگ اپنے مال کو محدود رکھتے ہیں, اپنے پاس جمع رکھتے ہیں اور زکات نہیں نکالتے ہیں, مستحقین تک نہیں پہنچاتے ہیں, اللہ تعالیٰ ان کے مال سے برکت کو اٹھا لیتا ہے. And then they complain that we are bankrupt, we've not got enough money, this has happened to us. It is because we do not look at the wealth, that it is a gift of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and a portion of it is the right of the poor people whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has assigned to actually take from the wealth that we possess. And if we withhold that wealth from them, we are actually violating their rights, and therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will show us the punishment in this dunya, and more so, and a bitter some punishment in the hereafter. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us from that. There's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in which it has been stated, narrated by Imam al-Tabarani radiallahu ta'ala anhu, أن النبي صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم دخل على بلال وعنده سبر من تمر. کہ حضور اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم سے بلال رضی اللہ عنہ کے پاس تشریف لائے اور حضرت بلال رضی اللہ عنہ کے پاس کھجور کا ایک ٹوکرا تھا. The Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم entered where حضرت بلال رضی اللہ عنہ was sat, and the Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم found with him a bunch of dates, a small bunch of dates, nothing in our view. فَقَالَ مَا هَذَا يَا بِلَال. The Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم asked, you know, to teach him, what is this, O Bilal? Look at how the Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم was sent to actually perfect people so that they do not have even the slightest item of hub, love for this dunya. Even having a bunch of dates and hoarding it for the next day was deemed in the sight of the companions as a sin. And look at here what the Prophet says to him. Has a Bilal ibn Umar said, أَعَدَتُهُ لِأَضِيَافِكْ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. I have reserved it, I have kept this bunch of dates, not fridge loads of drinks, loft full of flour and oil that we hold every single year when it's a sale, thinking that it's going to finish, we're not going to have any risk at all. Has a Bilal ibn said, I have kept this for my guest, for your guests, Ya Rasulullah. قال the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said أما تخشى أن يكون لك دخان في جهنم أنفق يا بلال ولا تخشى من ذي العرش من ذي العرش إغلالا. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم told him, O Bilal, spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Do you not fear that this, because of this hoarding this wealth, a bunch of dates, which is nothing, because of this you will be amidst the smoke of Jahannam? Do you not fear that? Look at the level that the companions were at. And whatever they gained, they used to spend in the way of Allah subhanahu, even hoarding or keeping, reserving, storing a bunch of dates was classed as a sin in their sight. And then the Prophet ﷺ said a very beautiful statement at the end, which reflects tawakkul, reliance on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is ar-razaq dhul quwwatin mateen. Allah yabsutu rizqa liman yasha'u wa yaqdir. He is the one who gives his sustenance and he spreads it to his bondsmen. Whoever he wishes he gives, whoever he wishes he restricts his risk from. And the Prophet ﷺ said here at this point, O Bilal, spend in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and do not fear from the one who possesses the mighty throne, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will always give you more and more and more. And this is very important in this day and age. Where they ask people, as you go to work, aap kaam pe jaate hain, to namazon ka kya karte hain? What do you do in relation to your namaz? He said, I do not have any time for namaz because I'm very busy at work. The time that I have for break or lunch time is very little. I do not have time to pray even my faraid. At this point, it is a very dangerous statement that they've said, to think that their risk comes from their employer and their reliance on Allah subhanahu wa has completely gone, whereas it is Allah subhanahu wa who will give you the risk. There are many brothers who have changed jobs, who have finished their work at one place, who do not let them pray their namaz, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given an abundance of risk after that. They have been given another job where it revolves around their namaz. They can pray the namaz on time and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has facilitated for them risk from, you know, places where they can't even think about. So always make namaz your priority, ibadah your priority, hukukullah your priority. If we start indulging in the dunya, thinking this is it, this is the be all and end all of everything, and this is the confined risk that I have to work in 9 to 5 like a robot, and forget the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, forget the namaz, forget zakat, forget salah, forget sawm, forget recitation of the Quran, then Allah subhanahu will immediately take out the barakah from your risk. You will be working tirelessly, as you say, working your socks off, but you will still be left with nothing. You will be left with nothing. You will, in the apparent state, have a lot of wealth, but there will be no risk, no barakah in it. And this is why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is admonishing his companions that to hoard even a bunch of dates for the companions of Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu was to result in him being amidst the smoke of the hellfire. And there's another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam which he mentioned to Hazrat Asma bint Abi Bakr Siddiq radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, the sister of Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told her, لا توكي فيوك وعليك. Do not restrict your risk from other people. Spend on people. Spend in the way of Allah subhanahu. If you start restricting the risk which Allah has given you, Allah will restrict the risk that He provides for you from the heavens. Allah will diminish the risk that He gives to you from the heavens. And there's another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam in which the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam again admonishes Hazrat Bilal radiallahu ta'ala. Hazrat Bilal was at that level that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went on the night of ascension, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, سَمِعْتُ خَشَّتَكَ أَمَامِي, I heard your footsteps before me, O Bilal, in Jannah. I.e. the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was about to enter, and as the state of a khadim is a servant who walks in front of the king, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam heard the footsteps of Hazrat Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam inquired, and he knew more than him, what was the reason why you gained such a prominent status in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that your footsteps were heard on the night of ascension in Jannah before me. Hazrat Bilal radiallahu ta'ala anhu said, whenever there is a hadath, whenever I break my ablution, I immediately perform wudu, and I perform two rakats tahiyatul wudu. Whenever I give the adhan, enter the masjid, I pray tahiyatul masjid. Because of the barakah of this namaz, I have a hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me that prominent status of which you have seen in Jannah, that you had heard my footsteps in Jannah before yourself. So the Bilal radiallahu ta'ala was admonished again here. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to him, Ya Bilal, mut faqiran wa la tamut ghaniyan. O Bilal, die as a poor, destitute man, and do not die as a person who is rich. And here there's another hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the first and foremost people, group of people who shall enter Jannah are going to be the poor people. They do not have money, and hence they don't indulge in sin. People who have a lot of money, they indulge in sin. They do not fulfill the rights of that wealth. So the Prophet ﷺ told, he admonished him and said, die as a poor man, do not die as a person who had affluence of wealth. Hazrat Bilal radiallahu ta'ala asked, وَكَيْفَ لِي بِذَلِكَ, how can I do that? And so the Prophet ﷺ said, مَا رُزِقْتَ فَلَا تَخْبَأْ وَمَا سُئِلْتَ فَلَا تَمْنَعْ, whatever is given to you, do not conceal from people. Give a share of it to the poor people. وَمَا سُئِلْتَ فَلَا تَمْنَعْ, and if you are asked for something, do not prevent it. I.e. if someone destitute comes to you, a poor man comes to you asking for something, then give whatever you have. فَقُلْتُ يَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ وَكَيْفَ لِي بِذَارِكَ, Hazrat Bilal radiallahu anhu said, how can I do that? The Prophet said, قَالَ هُوَ ذَاكَ أَوِ النَّارِ. Look at how strict it was. Either that, either you die as a poor man, or either it's the hellfire. There is no other option for them. These are the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, about whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that if they were to abstain or overlook or forsake even a tenth of religion, that would lead them to destruction. The companions, their state is very prominent in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah has given them the seal of rida, of ridwan, of jannah. Radiallahu anhum wa radu an. Allah is pleased with them, and they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at how they used to, you know, be with their wealth, how they used to deal with it. They used to completely give it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There's a hadith of Hazrat Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, narrated by Imam al-Tabarani. He says that أن عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله تعالى عنه أرسل 400 دينار مع الغلام إلى أبي عبيدة بن جراح رضي الله تعالى عنه مجمعين. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab sent 400 dinars. Dinar is a gold coin. To a servant of his. To who? To Hazrat Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. Hazrat Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah radiallahu ta'ala is from the Ashay Mubashareen. His mazashif is in Jordan radiallahu ta'ala. He was made shaheed. He was shaheed, I think, because of a plague outbreak that happened in the year, in the same year in which Hazrat Dirar ibn al-Azwar and the other great companions passed away in that plague epidemic, and anyone who dies in a plague dies as a shaheed. He died as a shaheed, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So Hazrat Umar sent 400 dinars with his khadim. Abne khadim ko bheja 400 dinar lekar ke. 400 dinar sone ke hote hain. Kin ki taraf? Hazrat Abu Ubaidah Jarrah radiallahu ta'ala ki taraf. وقال الغلام تلبس عنده في البيت ساعة لتنظر ما يصنع. And he said to his servant that when you give that money to him, then wait there for a little while. Hide somewhere and wait there for a little while and see and hear what he does with it. This was ikhtibar, this was a test, examination from Sayyidina Umar, Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn Khattab. فذهب بها الغلام إليه. The ghulam then went to him, to Abu Ubaid al-Jarrah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, وقال, and he said, Amir al-Mu'mineen يقول لك اجعل هذه في بعض حوائجك. Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar said, keep these 400 dinars and spend it for your need. Spend it on whatever you want. Spend it on your family, on your children, on your neighbors, and whatever you want to do with it. فقال وصله الله ورحمه. Hazrat Abu Ubaida radiallahu ta'ala said, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him his intimate friend and have mercy on him. ثم قال, then Hazrat Abu Ubaida said, تعالي يا جارية. Ebandi yahabia. He had a khadima, a maid servant. He told her, come here and take this. اذهبي بهذه السبعة إلى فلان. Take 7,000 of these dinanis. Seven hundred of these dinanis. Oh, sorry. Seventy of these dinanis to such and such a person. وبهذه الخمسة أيضا إلى فلان. And take 50 of these to such and such a person. And take this an extra amount to such and such a person. So what he did instantaneously when that 400 dinanis came to him, he immediately gave it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He didn't even leave a dinar for him. The ghulam then went to Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and he informed him about what Hazrat Abu Ubaidah did. And then when he informed him, Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala had already prepared another 400 dinars for Hazrat Mu'adh ibn Jabal. And he told the ghulam, اذهب بهذه إلى Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Take these to Hazrat Mu'adh ibn Jabal. His mazashik is also in Jordan radiallahu ta'ala anhu. أفقه الصحابة. وقف في البيت ساعة حتى تنظر ما يصنع. And stay in his home for a little while and see what he does and hear what he says. فذهب به الغلام. Then the غلام, after doing what he did with Hazrat Abu Ubaid ibn Jarrah radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he did the same with Hazrat Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Took 400 dinars. It's a huge amount. 400 dinars is a huge amount. Bearing in mind the fact that a dinar is a gold coin, pure gold. So he said, the ghulam then went, the khadim went to Hazrat Mu'adh ibn Jabal and said, Amir al-Mu'mineen, ij'al hadhihi fi ba'd hajatik. Use this for your needs, for the needs of your family. فقال رحمه الله وبصلا. May Allah have mercy on him, on Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him his intimate friend. Then he said, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, تعالي يا جارية, come, O maid servant, اذهبي إلى بيت فلان بكذا وإلى بيت فلان بكذا. Go to such and such a person's house with such an amount of dinanir. Give it to them, they are more in need than us. Go to such and such a person, give this to them. Go to such and such a person, give this to them. What happened? فطلعت امرأة معاذ. The wife of Mu'adh ibn Jabal, she kind of found out that 400 dinars have come to their house and Hazrat Mu'adh is distributing them very quickly. فَقَالَتْ وَنَحْنُ وَاللَّهِ مَسَاكِينَ. And she said, by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are more in need of that wealth. We are masakeen. We do not have enough wealth that we can have food for one day. We are masakeen. فَعَطِنَا. O Mu'adh, give us something. فَلَمْ يَبْقَ فِي الْخِرْقَةِ إِلَّا دِينَارَانَ فَرْسَلَهُمَا إِلَيْهَا. In that cloth in which were 400 dinanis, only 2 dinars were left, which were sent to the wife of the Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Look at their taqwa. Look at how they abstain from the love of this dunya. Look at how wealth used to come in one hand and they used to give it immediately with the other. And then the ghulam then went to Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu ta'ala anhu, فَأَخْضَرَهُ. And he informed him. فَسَرَّ بِذَلِكِ. He became immensely overjoyed, immensely happy. And he said, these are the people within the Ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam who I am going to use and appoint, you know, for different faculties when he was in the office of Khilafat. And these are the people who are very righteous, God-fearing, pious servants of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. 400 dinars go to them and they distribute them, leaving nothing for themselves. To the extent that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam himself, what happened sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? To the extent the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to give so much wealth in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the latter days of his physical life. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is hayyun fariyun fi khabri sharif. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is still alive in his best mazashi. This is his physical riyam, the world that he was living in sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before he veiled himself from our eyes. It says هي كانت عند رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم سبعة دنانير فوضعها عند عائشة. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had 7 dinars which he left with his Aisha Siddiq رضي الله تعالى عنها. فلما كان عند مرضه قال, when the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was in the illness which led to him meeting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, يا عائشة ابعثي بالذهب إلى علي, take these gold dinars to Hazrat Ali رضي الله تعالى عنه, so that he can distribute them. ثم أغمي علي, then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم fell unconscious because of the intensity of the illness. وشغل عائشة حتى قال ذلك مرارا, and Hazrat Aisha became busy asking for people to come and do علاج of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. He became busy, she forgot, but the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم repeated that again as soon as he gained consciousness. ويغمى على رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ويشغل عائشة ما به فبعث إلى علي فتصدق به. Every time the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم used to have that time, that period where he used to regain consciousness, he would say, what has happened to those dinars? Have you given them to Ali? I do not want even a single dinar to be in my house without it being given in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. فبعث إلى علي فتصدق به. At the end it was given to Ali رضي الله عنه, and he gave it in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وأمسى رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حديد الموت. That evening, Laylatul Ithnain, Monday evening, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wa sallam was in the agonies of death, sallallahu alaihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. فارسلت عائشة بمصباح لها إلى امرأة من نسائها فقالت, look at how little they had in their house. Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wa sallam was in such pain, Hazrat Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she didn't have enough oil to put into the lamp in order to give light, so that it could be easy for people, for visitors to come to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. She sent this lamp to one of her family friends, to the women, and she said, أهدي لنا في مصباحنا من السمن فإن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أمسى في حديد الموت. Put some oil in this lamp for us, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is now in the agonies of death. They didn't have even enough wealth to buy oil in order to put that into the lamp in the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the house of someone in whose hands is the treasures of the dunya and the akhirah, in the house of someone who is rahmatul alameen, in the house of someone who, in one hadith he said, if I wanted, mountains of gold would walk beside me. But this is the attitude the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the awliya, the salihin, the sahaba are giving towards the world. The world is hulwatun khabira. In the apparent state it is beautiful, it is very luring. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ مُسْتَخْلِفُكُمْ فِيهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to put you into this world, فَيَنْظُرَ كَيْفَ تَعْمَلُونَ, so that he tests you, he sees what you do. فَاتَّقُوا الدُّنْيَا وَاتَّقُوا النِّسَاءِ, fear from the dissension and the fitna of this world of hoarding wealth, and fear from the fitna of women. Two things which we should all remember. May Allah subhanahu give me and everyone taught you to do that. درش بر الله صلى على سيدنا مولانا محمد بعد الجود والكرم والي وصحبه وبارك وسلم صلى عليه. ان شاء الله a couple of minutes in relation to speaking about the great noble companion of the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, who is also a sahabi and from the Ahl Bayt of the Prophet صلى الله عليه واله وصحبه وسلم, سيدنا حمزة أسد الله وأسد رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم ورضي الله تعالى عنه. Because his Wisal Sharif date was on the 15th of Shawwal, we were supposed to do it last week, but unfortunately as it was we couldn't do it. Inshallah we shall mention a few of his merits and virtues and his maqam in the sight of Allah and his Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم from this kitab that we have before us, in hope and aspiration that just as he martyred himself and he was mercilessly mutilated afterwards, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq to sacrifice whatever we can, our time, our wealth, our skills, our honor, whatever we can for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so that we do not face humiliation before such great martyrs like Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, Ammu Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, his kunyat, his appellation was Abu Amara, and his title was Sayyidu Shuhada. This was the title given to him by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Sayyidu Shuhada, the Imam, the leaders of all the Shuhada, the martyrs. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in one hadith, as narrated by in Mu'jam of Imam al-Baghawi, And this has been cited by Imam Abdul Haq, Muhaddith al-Dihlawi, radiallahu in Madarij al-Nubuwa. He says, کہ حضور اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم نے ارشاد فرمایا مجھے قسم ہے اس خدای ذوالجلال کی کہ جس کے قبض قدرت میں میری جان ہے ساتوں آسمان میں لکھا ہوا ہے کہ حمزہ تو اسد اللہ و اسد رسولی کہ حمزہ اللہ کے پیارے رسول کے شعر ہیں The Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم said in one hadith By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in whose control is my soul In all the seven heavens it has been written, scribed on every single part of the heaven Hamza is the lion of Allah and the lion of the Messenger of Allah to show his courage, his strength, his power, his maqam in the sight of Allah and his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. حضرت حمزہ رضی اللہ تعالی عنہ اعلان نبوت کے دوسرے یا بعض لوگوں کے نزدیک چھٹے سال حضرت عمر فاروق اعظم رضی اللہ تعالی عنہ کی اسلام لانے سے تین دن پہلے اسلام لائے 3 days prior to the Islam of حضرت فاروق اعظم رضی اللہ تعالی عنہ حضرت عمر بن خطاب رضی اللہ عنہ حضرت حمزہ embraced اسلام آپ حضور اکرم صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم سے عمر میں صرف 2 برس بڑے تھے He was only 2 years older than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Now, how did he embrace Islam? It has been stated that it was the routine of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu before he embraced Islam that he used to go for hunting. And as soon as he returned back from hunting, the first thing that he used to do was to put the bow around his neck and do the tawaf of the Kaaba. In the manner that was practiced by those people before then, I don't know if there is 7 circuits, I don't know how it was in the time of Jahiliyyah or in the time before the Prophet ﷺ did the Ayran Nubuwa and gave strict regulations. You know, in the times before, in the period of ignorance, they used to do the tawaf naked. And it was after the Prophet ﷺ told them that you cannot do that, it is similar, akin to namaz, and therefore the etiquette of namaz should be borne in mind when you do the tawaf. Some people, when they do tawaf of the Kaaba, we notice them, witnessed many times, people who go for the first time, they're really excited, they're doing the first tawaf, which should be completely engrossed in the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking, beseeching His mercy, and they're on their phone and saying, I'm doing my first tawaf, I've done my second circuit, I'm on. You know, these things should be completely left away. You go there to completely detach yourself from this dunya. People go in front of the rose of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with mobile phones in their hands and taking pictures of the rose of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Do you go like this in a manner to a king? Let alone the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let alone Sayyid al-Mursaleen. Let alone the King of all kings, the Master of creation, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. At most, there are awliya who did not even, for the time that they spent in Medina Sharif, raise their eyes to see the golden mesh, the golden cage. In front of the rose of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, out of sheer humility and humbleness, out of sheer shame before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And here it's just become like you go to a trip, you go abroad for a holiday. There are women who have their backs against Gumbad al-Khazashi from afar, and they are posing for their pictures to be taken, and they can show to people, look at myself, I'm having my back against the Gumbad al-Khazashi. Much ignorance has come, and unfortunate as it is, things that should have been stopped by the police over there, by the mutawwa, they're not stopping, they're letting people take their shoes inside, do stupid things, put the mushaf on the floor, have their feet towards the qibla, they don't say shirk and bid'ah to them, they say be as you are. But when someone comes and goes in front of the rose of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the salatu salam, beseeches the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the tawassul of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as was the practice of the Prophet before the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba and the Tabi'in and Tabi' Tabi'in, they say this is shirk and bid'ah, they push you by force. And some incidents of them will be told, informed to you inshallah at a later date. Anyhow, so Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he once, as per his routine, was coming back from hunting. And before that, what happened? The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was around Kaaba Sharif, near Safa Marwa, that area. And Abu Jahl, la'anatullahi alayhi, the arch enemy of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he started to scold the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he started to ridicule him, he started to call him names, you are a sorcerer, you are a magician, you are this, you are that. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, through his noble character, he just had his noble eyes lowered. And he just went. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma rahmatin min Allah limta lahum." The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was absolute mercy. He never took revenge for his own personal things. But whenever the hudud Allah were transgressed, whenever the limits of Allah were transgressed, that is when he took revenge for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but not for his own self. Someone called him names, the Prophet ﷺ forgave them. Someone scolded him, the Prophet ﷺ forgave them. Someone swore at him, the Prophet ﷺ forgave him. To the extent there was a Bedouin who actually said in a battlefield that, Ya Rasul, that, O Muhammad, you and your family of Quraysh do not ask miserly people, you do not spend wise in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you do not distribute the booty that is left after the war with just equally. And the Prophet ﷺ forgave him. The Prophet ﷺ never retaliated, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So the Prophet ﷺ, after hearing the comments of Abu Jahl, the Prophet ﷺ had his head lowered and he went. But witnessing this was a maidservant of a Sahabi, Abdullah bin Jad'an. I think he was a Sahabi. She was a maidservant. She was stood on Mount Safa and she was witnessing this conversation. In fact, it was a one-way conversation of Abu Jahl scolding the Prophet ﷺ and swearing at him. And then when Hazrat Hamza came back as per his routine towards the Kaaba Sharif, she approached Hazrat Hamza, the uncle of the Prophet ﷺ. He had not yet embraced Islam, and she said, do you know what happened today? Abu Jahl did certain such a thing to your nephew, to the Prophet ﷺ, and he remained silent. Hazrat Hamza then affirmed, did he really do that? Then the maidservant said, yes, he really did that. Then Hazrat Hamza radiallahu anhu became infuriated. He was not yet a Muslim. And he went. And Abu Jahl, as per his routine, he would then go to the Majlis al-Shura, the committee that they had within the Haram of the Kaaba Sharif, the Mabaf, and he would sit there. Hazrat Hamza radiallahu anhu with his bow already around his neck, and against his routine to do the Tawaf of the Kaaba, he went straight to Abu Jahl, and with his bow, he struck him on his head so fiercely, with such a great blow that he made a crack, that made a split in his head. He began to bleed profusely. And then the people stood up and they tried to stop Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and some people from the tribe of Banu Makhzum, they said, well, have you become Muslim? Has Hamza not yet embraced Islam? He just said out of this state of anger that he had, yes, I've become a Muslim, and who is there to stop me? He said this. And then he went direct to the Prophet sallallahu wasallam, and he said, oh my nephew, glad tidings to you, I've taken revenge on your behalf. Be happy. What did the Prophet ﷺ say? The Prophet ﷺ said, Chacha, mujhe khushi badla lene se nahi, balki aapke iman se hai. I will only become pleased when you embrace faith. At that point, Hazrat Amir Hamza radiallahu ta'ala said, let this moment be a kunus to your eyes. I bear witness, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa annaka rasulullah. I bear witness that there is no one worthy of worship and you are the greatest messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He embraced Islam at that point. And as you know, 3 days later, Hazrat Umar ibn Khattab then embraced Islam. And after that, the Muslims had great force, great izzah. They used to openly do the ibadah of Allah subhanahu within the haram of the Kaaba Sharif. Now, how was he martyred? As you know, in the 3rd year after the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, after the great battle of Badr, the following year, out of revenge, when the kuffar were killed, 70 of them were killed, 70 of them were imprisoned, and the rest of them, they fled the battlefield with humiliation. They said, we are going to take revenge the following year. What happened? They actually gathered in the plain of Uhud. Uhud is approximately 3 miles away from Medina Sharif. Uhud is named after, the place is named after the mountain which is there, the mountain from Jannah, about which the Prophet said, Uhud, Jabalun yuhibbuna wa nuhibbuhu. Uhud is a mountain which loves us and we love it. Subhanallah. An inanimate object which has no life in it, in the apparent state. But this is a mountain about which the Prophet said, this is a mountain from Jannah, it loves me and I love that mountain. Uhud, Jabal Uhud. And this is why, in one narration in Bukhari Sharif, when the Prophet Hazrat Abu Siddiq and Hazrat Umar radiallahu ta'ala anhuma and Sayyidina Uthman ibn Affan radiallahu anhu was stood on it, it began to shake. Why did it shake? The ulama state here, it began to shake out of ecstatic love of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his companions are stood on me, it began to shake out of the love. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, Uthbut ya Uhud fa innama alayka nabiyyun wa siddiqun wa shahidan. Stay calm, O Uhud, don't you know that there is a Prophet on you and Siddiq and two martyrs in the favor of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Umar was martyred and Uthman was martyred, radiallahu ta'ala ajma'in. So the battle of Uhud took place, and as for the command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, it was victory until the time when there were 70 arrow shooters who were commanded by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to stay on the mountain regardless of there being signs of victory or not. But out of the taqdeer of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the hikmah which Allah knows best, the Sahaba did not go against the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was an error which was through ijtihad. And if someone makes an error through ijtihad, if they are incorrect, they get one thawab, and if they are correct, they get double the reward. They were not going against the command of the Prophet. How can someone who has been guaranteed rida and pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala go against the command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? That happened, and then there was a second attack from the kuffar, and because of that many martyrdoms took place of the sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Amongst them has Amir Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. What happened, has Hamza radiallahu ta'ala was going in the flanks of the kuffar. He was a courageous man. He was Asadullah wa Asadullah, the lion of Allah, the lion of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As Hamza was going through the flanks of the kuffar, and he had two swords with him. He used to carry two swords with him, one in each hand, and he used to slay the kuffar after the respect of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What happened was, he was about to go and attack someone. Behind a rock was hiding someone who then became a companion, Wahshi, who became Hazrat Wahshi radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was hiding behind a rock. He was a servant of Jubair bin Mut'im bin Adi. And Mut'im ibn Adi, the uncle of Jubair, he was killed by Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala in the Battle of Badr. So to take revenge on behalf of his uncle, Jubair bin Mut'im said, "O Wahshi, I shall pay you an X amount, and you will be freed, you will be emancipated if you kill, astaghfirullah, if you martyr Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu." Wahshi didn't embrace Islam at that time. He had his target with him, he had a spear with him, and he targeted the navel of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala. He threw the spear, and it landed in the navel of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala. Hazrat Hamza turned back to grab hold of him, but before he could even reach, he fell and he passed away. Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. But what happens after that is even worse. One is martyrdom, but one is to be brutally killed, and one on top of that is to be mercilessly mutilated. What happened after that? Hind bin Utba, she was the wife of Abu Sufyan, and her father, her dad, Utba, he was killed by the Muslims in the Battle of Badr. So again, to take revenge for that, she told Wahshi, "Where is Hamza's body?" So she went to the body of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu as the spear lied in his navel, and what she did, she took a knife, she split open the stomach of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, and she took the liver out. She bit it with her mouth and she spat it out. Then she took the intestines out of the body. This is in narration, this is what actually happened. Then she mutilated his body so mercilessly that she cut his ears, she cut his nose, she took his noble eyes out. She mutilated the face of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu. At the end, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the battle had finished, when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu, "Go, where is my uncle? Go and find my uncle." Hazrat Ali radiallahu anhu went, and when he saw the body of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu in the state as it was, he cried uncontrollably. He went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He could not even relay back the information about the state of the body of the Prophet. The Prophet went, and Hazrat Abdullah bin Mas'ud, in one narration he says, "We never saw the Prophet crying as much as he did when he saw the body of Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala." The great martyrs of Uhud, these are the great companions of the Prophet who sacrificed their life, their bodies were mutilated. Hazrat Musa ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala, one of the richest men of Medina Sharif, when he embraced Islam, he gave every single amount of dinar and danali in the sake of Allah, in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They could not even find enough kafan, shroud, that when they used to cover his head, it would uncover his legs, and when they used to cover his legs, it would uncover his face. So what they did, they covered his blessed face with the shroud, and they put grass on his blessed feet. This is how they were, you know, martyred. This is how they were shrouded, radiallahu ta'ala majma'in. And then Sheikh Abdul Haq Mahdi Dili says about the hayat of the shuhada. They are alive. By Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they are alive. There's a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in which he says that any person, this goes contrary to the Wahhabi pamphlet that they actually distributed when we went there, if you remember, the Martyrs of Uhud, and in it they wrote, do not call upon the dead, they are dead people, they can neither benefit nor cause harm. This is what they put. I should bring that pamphlet, inshallah, if I have it, and show it to you. This is what they distribute there. And the Prophet ﷺ is saying, any visitor who goes to the Martyrs of Uhud and says, As-salamu alaykum ya shuhada'a Uhud, peace be upon you, O Martyrs of Uhud, they will surely hear the reply back to their salam. Imam Nabhani says in Jami Karamat al-Awliya, Hazrat Hamza about the Mazashi was Hamza al-Dulatran, that there was a woman called Fatima from Khuza'iyah, Fatima al-Khuza'iyah radiallahu ta'ala anha. She went to the uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, and she said, Ya Amma Rasulillah, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. O uncle of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings be upon you. And she said, I heard a reply coming from Hazrat Hamza, wa alayki salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, may peace be upon you and the mercy of Allah and His blessings. And there are many narrations that have been written by the awliya and the salihid. Imam Nabhani narrates a narration where someone, he was having a difficult time in Medina Sharif. Two of his camels died, which were the only means of his transport back to Egypt. Two of his camels died. He didn't have no means to go back. He told his sheikh, Al-Khashashi radiallahu anhu, what shall I do? And his sheikh said, go to Amir Hamza radiallahu anhu. And this is why the awliya also state, کہ اگر آپ کی حاجت پوری کرنی ہو مدینہ شریف میں تو سب سے پہلے امیر حمزہ رضی اللہ عنہ کی بارگاہ میں جاؤ اور آپ کا توسل حضور کی بارگاہ میں پیش آپ ان کی بارگاہ میں دعا کرو اور آپ کا توسل حضور کی بارگاہ میں پیش کرو انشاءاللہ حضور صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم کبھی بھی ان کے چچا کی سفارش کو رد نہیں فرمائیں گے That's why when you go to حضرت امیر حمزہ مزار شریف then go straight to the rows of the Prophet صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم say یا رسول اللہ صلی اللہ علیہ وسلم through the tawassul of your noble uncle and the dua that we have made and how we have made him a mediation in your court, Ya Rasulullah, accept our plea, our dua, the Prophet will indeed listen to your prayers and supplication. So the person went to his sheikh, told him, go to Amir Hamza radiallahu ta'ala anhu, pray Fatiha, whatever ma tayassam al-Qur'an, whatever you can read from the Qur'an, and seek a tawassul from him, and then see what happens. So he went, prayed Fatiha, and then he left his mother in the masjid, this person who was in great agony, in a great state of anxiety. When he came to the masjid, he met his mother. His mother said, where have you been all this time? Go to such and such a person. I've seen this person who has come, who's told me, who said your name. And he asked me where you are, and I told him he's going to come back later on, so go to him. So that person asked his mother, where is that person? She pointed towards the direction where that person had left. The person went there. When he went there, he saw a noble man of great stature, of a huge build. He was in very heavy stock. He was built, muscular, and he had a noble rish, Mubarak Sharif, a white beard that filled his chest. He was a noble man that all used to be emanated from his noble face. He did salam to that person. He said, are you such and such a person? He said, yes, I am such and such a person. Come with me. This sheikh, this noble buzurg, said, come with me. So he took him to where they used to transport, where they used to have all the camels for transportation, for people to travel on to other places. And this noble sheikh then said to the person who was going to ride that camel, the driver of the camel, take these two people with safety, security, and I will pay you the amount of money that you need. Then the sheikh then went and he disappeared. The person who was in a state of anxiety, he went to his sheikh and he said, oh my sheikh, you told me to go to Hazrat Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, and then this happened that I saw a sheikh who actually paid for my ride back to Egypt. He helped me a lot and then he disappeared from my eyes. His sheikh said, that was the spirit of Abir Hamza radiallahu ta'ala came to help you. Subhanallah. And the exact same incident happened with the Khalifa of Allah, Hazrat Zuqud bin Medina radiallahu ta'ala, when he first went to Medina Sharif, he didn't have anywhere to stay, he didn't have any food or water. He went to Amir Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, and then he saw a sheikh filled with awe. That was Amir Hamza radiallahu ta'ala, who aided him, who helped him, who assisted him all throughout his journey, all throughout his stay in Medina Sharif. Subhanallah. So the Martyrs of Uhud are Hayya, they are Hayy, they are alive in their Mazar Sharif. Shaykh Abdul Haq Mahdi's Delhi resident said, after 40 years of their burial, there was a flood that came. There was a flood that came and it opened the graves of the Martyrs of Uhud. And their bodies were opened, their bodies were opened and people could see them. And they saw that they had their hands on their wounds and their faces and their bodies were completely intact. It seemed as though they were buried today, even after 40 years. And as per the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, to the Yawm al-Qiyamah, every visitor who goes there with sincerity, they will hear the reply back from the people of Uhud, from the martyrs of Uhud. So as long as he has sincerity in his heart, he will hear the reply of the salam to them. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the sadqa of Hazami Hamza radiallahu ta'ala forgive our sins. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to do the khidmah of the deen as much as we can. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be pleased with the martyrs of Uhud, and through their sadqa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sins and give us the tawfiq and the himmah and this noble blessing that we visit their mazar sharif again and again and again. Al-Fatiha ila ruhihi sharifa. قل هو الله احد الله الصمد لم يلد ولم يولد اللهم صل على سيدنا ومولانا محمد طب القلوب ودوائها وعافية الأبدان وشفائها ونور الأبصار وضيائها وعلى آله وصحبه دائما أبدا. اللهم ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم نق قلوبنا من الحقد والحسد والبغض والمعاداة. اللهم إنا نتوسل ونتوجه إليك بحبيبك المصطفى يا رسول الله. إنا نتوسل ونتوجه إليك في قضاء حاجاتنا هذه فشفع فينا يا رب العالمين. اللهم استر عوراتنا وآمن روعاتنا. اللهم استر عوراتنا وآمن روعاتنا. اللهم استرنا بسترك الجميل. اللهم استرنا بسترك الجميل. اللهم استرنا بسترك الجميل. اللهم ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم. وتب علينا يا مولانا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. إن الله ملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. جزا الله عنا سيدنا مولانا محمدا صلى الله عليه وآله وصحبه وسلم ما هو أهله. سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.